Then we add Jake Hager debuting as the All-American American.
Jake Swagger. Was it? I thought it was Jack.
I think it's Jack. I think it's Jake Swagger.
Either way. This is the best name I ever heard in my life. This is a name that I suspect Freddie Prinze Jr. Was part of like an email wrestling league when he was 10 years old. And he had a guy named Jack Swagger. And now he has brought it to ECW. The All-American-American Jack Swagger. Wrestling name ever.
He looks like a cross between Josh Barnett and Bryan Danielson.
He does. That's his name. I saw that name and I thought, holy shit, that's a great fucking name. And then out came a caveman. It's like, huh. You don't look very All-American nor particularly swaggerish.
He looks All-American. He's a blonde and he's got this big smile.
He's got the Josh Barnett's a good one because he's got that big goofy grin pasted on his face kind of permanently.
No, the grin is Bryan Danielson's.
I see.
That's where it came from. If you see this guy, he's Josh Barnett and Bryan Danielson put together. And anyway, he did the deal that I wanted Shelton to do,
That's my exact thought. This guy gets to be the amateur ace, and Shelton Benjamin has to be just another guy?
Exactly. And he hit a blue thunder bomb for the finish, which was identified by the teacher as a blue thunder bomb.
Wrestling nerd.
God, he's a nerd. He even admitted it.
He calls himself that.
Yeah. So there's hope for this man.
It was a fine squash.
And unlike all these other geeks that have debuted of late and been buried, he has good size, so he's going to get a good chance here.
Well, he's better than Ricky Ortiz.
Colt Cabana.
No, not better than Colt Cabana.
Yeah.
So there you go.
And Sean Spears. That's right. Fool. The new greatest wrestler in history is Jack Swagger.
This is a dream match that I didn't even know I wanted to see.
You know, I don't know if they listen to this show. I'm just going to presume that WWE listens to this program. Because I could have sworn that last week he was Jake Swagger. And you suggested Jack Swagger. And I said, nope, sadly it's Jake.
I think you're just mistaken.
It's Jack Swagger now.
I think it was Jack Swagger last week and you were wrong.
I'm going to go back and check my report.
Your report was wrong. You wrote it.
Well, fine. I'll check the report on the front page then.
All right.
Would that report be wrong?
Did somebody else write it?
Yeah.
Then it's probably right.
Well, let's just find out here, jackass.
What? I'm holding my breath in anticipation.
Let's see.
I can't sit still. Look at me. Look, I'm not sitting still.
Why the fuck would the ECW report be? I presume that would have to be on
page. If only the front page were organized.
What day is ECW?
Tuesday.
Oh, so I guess it would be on the other page.
Uh-huh.
There we go.
Just keep on scrolling, buddy.
September 9. What do we got? It was Jack Swagger. Well, that's bullshit. Anyway.
So, he wrestled again this week.
I think this guy was wrong. Let me see what I wrote in the newsletter. Maybe I was just wrong here and I got it right in the newsletter.
I think you were wrong everywhere.
Vince, we all know that I've never been wrong.
I forgot. My bad.
My own website made me sign in right there.
That is funny.
Fucker. You are not authorized to view this resource.
You've been banned from the...
I have an idea. Blow me. Why can I not log into my own website?
Uh-oh. We found a bug.
You are not authorized to view this resource. Does this happen to everybody, or is it just happening to me?
It happens to me like every day, the first time I go to it.
Why will it not let me log in?
Are you typing your name?
Yeah. What the fuck? Nails! Tony!
Thank God this is not a free show. The site has rejected its owner. The site... Like Cyberdyne in Terminator 2 has grown artificial intelligence and taken over the world.
You're not authorized to... The website is seriously failing me right now. Does this to you every day?
Well, yeah, but then I sign in and then it works.
Well, I can't sign in, geek. You are not authorized to view this resource.
Can you view the board? You're recording?
Yeah?
That's good.
There we go. That was fucking weird. Wonder what happened there. All right.
With that out of the way.
With that out of the way, let's go to the ECW report here. Let's see. ECW on Sci-Fi. The All-American Jake Swagger.
You really are a small little man.
Somebody was wrong here, and it wasn't me. Who could this have been?
You are an astoundingly weak human being sometimes.
This can't be right. It had to be Jack Swagger. It had to be Jake Swagger last week. I need confirmation of this, somebody. Somebody prove to me that I was not wrong in this case. Because Jack Swagger's a better name. How could I have screwed it up? It's impossible. So anyway.
So we had a dream match here.
So
in Jack Swagger's second week.
Jake Swagger got a new name this week. He is now being called Jack Swagger, which is a million times better than Jake. And he faced Mickey Rourke. And they were having the squash match here.
I understand you're making a joke there. That's what he looked like. He fought Chase Stevens.
No, come on.
Do you know who Chase Stevens is,
Bryan? The Blonde Natural.
He fought the Blonde Natural.
This is
the
bullshit.
All-American-American Jack Swagger versus the Blonde-Haired Natural. When I saw who that was, I was excited when Jack Swagger came out. And when I saw he was wrestling the Blonde-Haired Natural, I went, woohoo! I thrust my arms to the sky and was very, very happy.
His blonde hair is now going black.
Less natural than it used to be?
Yeah, he's very... I just realized he was very unnatural.
He was in fact, false.
So Jack Swagger,
artificial,
with his wacky grin, did a whole bunch of amateur moves, threw the man around, and then one with the red, white, and blue Thunder Bomb. Jack Swagger.
Star.
The best ever.
I was going to say future star.
Jack Swagger.
He's a star as we speak.
Jack Swagger and Velvet Sky.
Ooh.
The two biggest stars in professional wrestling today.
That would be awesome.
Awesome.
He put on a fine display. He is, as you noted, a really big, really scary guy. He was, I don't know if he was more comfortable on the stage this week or what, but he threw the Blonde-Haired Natural around. It was a grand display, and I can't say it's my favorite part because the match was so much fun, but Grisham, in the middle of this match, began to discuss the Blonde-Haired Natural and saying he had paid his dues, which is a strange thing to say, considering no one watching this show knew who he was, but whatever. It made the match even more fun. This was a giant thumbs-up segment.
Mike Knox and Chase Stevens. Chase Stevens, everybody, of Natural's fame. He's done something to his hair this week. I don't know what it is.
It's even less natural.
And nothing has changed in the life of Chase Stevens because he came out and I thought he was Ryan Braddock. I thought for sure. So anyway, Knox killed him.
He took a hell of a beating here.
And
he's taking great turnbuckle bumps and everything. This is a fine Chase Stevens match.
And afterwards, Jack Swagger came out, who is my new favorite wrestler on the earth. And he killed Stevens with a Doctor Bomb, and Dreamer made the save, and killed him with a Doctor Bomb, too. And I have compared Jack Swagger to Josh Barnett and Bryan Danielson, a mix between the two. And he does, in fact, have the genetics of Josh Barnett, because his gut is not in the best shape.
No, he's not going to win any modeling contest or bodybuilding contest anytime soon, but... This is a strange segment because what's it all lead to? Is it going to be Mike Knox and Jack Swagger versus Tommy Dreamer and Chase Stevens?
I hope so.
I will say that...
That sounds like an awesome match on ECW.
Jack Swagger and Mike Knox would make a hell of a tag team, but...
They're awesome.
It was a strange, strange bit.
Jack Swagger and Lenny Lane.
Yes!
Not that Lenny Lane, by the way.
Oh, wasn't?
No.
How can there be... Wait.
I believe this is a new Lenny Lane.
Are you telling me there are two Lenny Lanes?
Yeah.
When I saw the All-American-American Jack Swagger, first of all, that alone got me super hyper and excited. And then I saw he was wrestling Lenny Lane. Last week, he beats half the Naturals. This week, he beats half the West Hollywood Blondes. Next week, it should be Kenny Chaos. The week after that, Scotty Riggs. Then a ding-dong. This will be awesome.
I wrestled a couple of weeks ago at Tulalip Championship Wrestling, where, in fact, I injured my back. But anyway, they drew 39 paid. There wasn't a single match on that show that had less heat than this did.
That's totally true.
This was absolute, complete silence in the arena.
It was eerie.
All right. ECW. I haven't totally lost my mind yet. I haven't opened up the lines. But I think it's inevitable that's going to happen. I just keep looking at how long the show goes, and it's like, do I really want to waste the time tonight? Had a very long week, everybody. It's been tough. So I'm not so sure about this. So while I decide, let's review ECW. Tommy Dreamer and Finley against Jack Swagger and Mike Knox. It was a fine little TV match. It was, I believe, the first non-squash match on WWE TV by Jack Swagger. And it was fine. Anyway, the ref got distracted. Midget hit Knox with a splash off the top. Ref got rid of the little fella. Finley hit Knox with his gimmick for the pin. And it was interesting. I guess the one thing to note in this was, of the available options, they did not pin Jack Swagger.
That is true.
So they like the man.
They do, as well they should. He's the all-American American, Jack Swagger. The most notable thing is not the match itself, but they filmed ECW this week in Spokane, Washington, where apparently nothing exciting has happened literally this century, because when Fit Finley pinned Mike Knox here, the Spokane arena went absolutely batshit crazy. It was so freaking loud there. The fans were so excited by this ECW tag match. It was overwhelming.
And Jack Swagger and Brett Baderly. Go ahead.
Well, Brett Baderly did not unend Jack Swagger's winning streak. He lost quickly in short order to the Dr. Bomb. And then Todd Grisham from the commentary booth went in to do a promo with Jack Swagger. And he asked, hey, you've been trying to start shit with Tommy Dreamer. And why have you been trying to pick on a guy who's the flagship of ECW? And Jack Swagger put his hand to his chin and thought about it for a while, and then he said, who?
Tommy who?
Tommy who? And yeah. He left.
That was
a waste.
Hell of a promo. Then we had the clips of Jack Swagger saying Tommy who, which led to an interview with Dreamer, who said it was his 19th year in the business, and everyone knew Jack should be able to beat him in 5 minutes, but if you don't, what happens if I beat you? And this led to a match where Swagger beat Dreamer. Swagger is very green. Yeah. This was not very good. And Tommy Dreamer is a fat man and almost didn't get up for the powerbomb.
That's true. These are all true. Yeah, this is the not quite the first time seeing Jack Swagger in a real match. He's done tag matches before, but I think this is the first time seeing him in a one-on-one, back-and-forth, non-squash match. And yeah, he's got a long way to go. He's got a lot of work to do. He's still very talented, still very strong, still very big, still very charismatic. But yes, he needs a lot of work done on him. There were two fans I want to point out here. One was a great sign where a sign that read, and I'll just quote it here, I'm a black man on TV. And he just wanted to let us know that.
Wow.
And then there was a fan who was dressed up like the scariest Michael Jackson you ever saw. Just in a white unmoving mask, holding up a sequin glove and staring at it and shaking repeatedly, and it terrified me. And thank God for them, because the match was pretty boring.
Jack Swagger did a promo on Tommy Dreamer and started referencing a bunch of ECW history, some of which I'd even forgotten. And I thought, why would you do this on this show where it's all little kids right now who were fucking barely born in the 90s, for Christ's sake?
I believe the Tommy Dreamer Sandman Singapore Kane angle was at least 12 years ago.
So for those of you that have 8-year-olds, for example, that like this show, they weren't even born in the 90s. They were born in the 21st century.
My God, that's right.
So think about that when they do these ECW angles. So they did a promo, and he held up the old ECW title and said Dreamer had won this once, but it was only for 30 minutes, and this show had been on for longer than 30 minutes. And, of course, my immediate question was, if this were real, where the fuck did Jack Swagger get the original ECW title belt? Did nobody think about this?
Yard sale.
This is the stupidest thing I've ever seen.
Value Village.
He like came out with it like, oh, I was walking down the street. I was at a pawn shop in fucking Philadelphia, and look what I found.
I bet that's entirely possible, actually.
Then he had a picture of Beulah McGillicuddy, which got almost no reaction whatsoever.
Maybe not in the arena. In my room, it got a great reaction.
Well, too bad. And I don't want to know anything more. So then the Dreamer finally ran out and beat him up. Anyway, the point is, this was like a pretty good heel promo. Way to go, Jack Swagger.
Indeed.
A lot of men stepped up on this program.
Yes, yes, and he was one of them. And his first time to really shine as a speaker by himself. And he did a great job with the material that was given. You noted the valid critiques of how this stuff's also dated. But by the end, and when he started, by the way, fans not into this at all, including one guy who screamed, you're making me sleep. You're making me sleepy, was what he said. But then by the end, when he started talking about Beulah and Tommy's kids and how Tommy's a failure, and so that means your husband's a failure and your kids will be failures, people were going crazy booing him. So, yes, this was a great segment for Mr. Jack Swagger, the All-American American.
Stop referencing so much history. TNA and WWE are making the same mistake. It's fine that history exists, but it's better if you have if the usage of footage is to show, or the usage of history is to show footage of it, for
yes.
example.
Shows clips of Sandman hitting Tommy Dreamer with a cane.
Just mentioning ECW angles from 12 years ago, most of this audience is going to be like, what the fuck are you even talking about? And have no idea. And so they don't care. Much like Sting talking about AJ's father. I'll get into that later on.
That was dumber.
Crime Time Tommy Dreamer against Miz Morrison and Jack Swagger. This was not good. This was not good. There was Jack and Crime Time in particular at the beginning.
The brawl between Shad Gaspard and Jack Swagger, I will concede to you, was horrible.
It was quite hideous.
It was. I can't even call it wrestling school bad. It was just bad.
We had a dive by Tommy Dreamer, who he was compared to a Zeppelin, because he's fat, you know. And then we had some the highlight of this was really just the jibber-jabber back and forth between the teacher and Matt Stryker. Apparently, the teacher voted for McCain, and so the Matt Stryker, or Todd Grisham, had to rub it in throughout the show that Obama had won. So this led to quite a bit of comedy and irony, since apparently Matt Stryker is not part of the Teachers for Obama group. But they did all this wackiness, and there was some there was actually a great Stryker Grisham line at the end of the show where Grisham thought that the fireman's carry rule was the Celtic cross, and it had to be explained to him that no, that was the Emerald Fusion. This was a real argument that they had here on the air between two massive dorks.
Yeah, see,
a massive wrestling dork and just a massive dork.
A massive dork in life. But yeah, my Stryker actually said, No, that's the Rolling Hills. The Celtic Cross is an Emerald Fusion.
The Rolling Hills.
Which I've never heard it called before, not even once. Not even by Stryker.
So then
but
we
getting back to the six-man here, I enjoyed it. There was moments of great sloppiness, but it was a very cut-and-dry, formulaic six-man, and as we say, they should do one of these in every show because they're always good. And this one, even for sloppiness, was good, even when watching Tommy Dreamer run. And it's bad when Tommy Dreamer runs, but it's so bad it entertains me every single time. The number of steps he takes to get across the ring is always amuses me.
Yeah, you enjoy this way more than I did. This match was no good, everybody. It was bad at the beginning. It was okay in the middle when they got the heat on JTG. And then during the comeback, it was six guys running wild on each other, most of which were green. There was some sloppiness. And then Dreamer DDT'd Swagger, but then walked into a moonlight drive and got pinned. And that was the end of that. So,
thumbs up.
Thumbs down. There you go. And besides, what do we see next? An amateur challenge. That's not fake.
Oh, this was fake.
No, this was the best thing on the show. Jack Swagger beat the shit out of Tommy Dreamer, including getting his back and putting the hooks in and stretching him. This is the best thing I ever saw. And then he got in the referee's position, and Dreamer booted him and gave him a DDT, and I was entertained.
I was annoyed because they were apparently the referee was not up on his amateur wrestling rules, because Swagger got an immediate takedown and then stood up and backed away, and I thought, well, that should be 1 point for an escape for Tommy Dreamer. And no one noted anything.
No, it was.
Later they started counting them. The first one they forgot. Or if the ref counted it, the announcers made no note of it. But I was irritated that they were already screwing up their own rules. And then by the end it didn't matter because Tommy Dreamer just punted him in the ribs for the DQ, but that just, I don't know if amuse is the right word, but I've seen this thing done 1,000 times, and it's always the heel who can't wrestle and has to cheat.
This can't possibly, by the way, be an actual amateur wrestling rule, where if you take a man down and then let him up, that counts as an escape. How is that an escape? You freed him. There's a big difference.
I swear, and granted, it's been probably 20 years since amateur wrestled, but I could have sworn someone was just talking about a match where one guy had great takedowns but was not so great on the ground, and so he just took he would hit 1,000 takedowns, then let his opponent back to his feet, and that counted as an escape, and he just won on points.
If you've got a bunch of guys in jail, and you've got two jails, okay?
Brian, this is a stupid. We have a lot to talk about in the show.
No, but I'm just letting you do my analogy.
Fine.
You've got two jails. You're an editor. You've got two jails. In one jail, a man's in for 20 years. In another jail, men are in for life. In the first jail, the man's 20 years come up, and they just let him out. In the other jail, the guys dig a hole underneath the jail, come out, and flee. Would you actually write that both men escaped? No.
No, because that's not amateur wrestling, Brian.
One man was released, and one man escaped. Amateur wrestling. Why is everything so stupid today? I'm just getting angry at every conceivable thing right now. That is not an escape. Just take the guy down and you start all over again. What if it's like that in MMA? If, like, the guy's down there in the crab and you invite him back to his feet. If he stands up, does Abe Bilardo... Maybe that's why Abe Bilardo is such a shitty judge. He counts that as an escape.
Perhaps that is it.
And he gives men points when the other man just lets him stand up.
Perhaps that is it.
Jesus Christ. Boogeyman comes back next week. We had Atlas flirting with the blonde, and then Jack Swagger came up, and Atlas made fun of his lisp. I can't even believe they did that.
They're dumb.
These people have lost their minds. And then Swagger and Ortiz had an argument, and...
It was poorly acted.
Oh, God, this was the most horrible argument.
So then Teddy Long walked in. Yes. Teddy Long walked in and said, hey, you want Tommy Dreamer? Well, he wrestled your match this week. You will wrestle his match next week. So it's Jack Swagger versus Tommy Dreamer, Extreme Rules. I would just like to note that... Swagger walked in, and Tiffany was representing Teddy Long, and Swagger started to bitch about his match, and Tiffany said, oh, I wasn't watching.
Yeah.
She's not watching the show.
Of course not. I don't even know what her role is.
I don't think anyone does. I think
And Jack Swagger, in fact, asked that question.
Yes,
why
the topic came up.
Why aren't you watching the show? What is your job? She was flirting with Atlas Ortiz.
That's her job, apparently.
Which begs the question, what's Teddy Long's job?
Don't know.
He wasn't there either.
I don't know.
This show. And I like this show.
Yes.
Tommy Dreamer and Jack Swagger Extreme Rules. They had a really fun little match, actually. Dreamer did all of his goofiness, and there was actually, believe it or not, a story to this match, aside from both dudes hit each other with shit. The story was that Dreamer did what he did best, which is hitting people with garbage, and every now and then Jack Swagger would make a comeback by doing a wrestling move, and that made this whole thing great. And he ended up hitting him with his Dr. Bomb, or I guess, what do they call it for a while? The Red, White, and Blue Thunder Bomb through a table for the pin.
It's a Dr. Bomb.
This was a fun match.
It was a very fun match. It was significantly better than the hardcore match from Hogan Celebrity Championship Wrestling.
They should call it the Red, White, and Blue Thunder Bomb. That's just far better.
Than the Dr. Bomb?
Yeah.
He's not a doctor, so I guess you have that.
He's
going
all American.
He's the all American
Jack
Swagger.
The Red, White, and Blue Thunder Bomb.
That's fine. This match was fun. They did a great job of teasing and building the stuff. Like, Dreamer would set up the chair in the corner, and then they would leave it alone for like 2 minutes, and then suddenly Dreamer would go into it and stuff like that. They set up the table for several minutes before anyone actually went through it. And yeah, it was a very fun hardcore match. They did innovative stuff, like Jack Swagger applying a chair-assisted single-leg crab. Just fun stuff like that. And I was a little annoyed when he applied a submission hold, and Tommy Dreamer got the ropes here in this hardcore match. It annoyed me, but then they just kept wrestling, and I forgot about it, so it's fine. But yes, this was fun.
Miz and Morrison did some wackiness backstage and put over Survivor Series, and that was quite fascinating, and seeing as how they both got pinned.
That was odd. But I did love John Morrison referring to himself as the Chuck Norris of Nookie.
That's what he said. So then they were ranting, and the Boogeyman showed up, and they ran away. And this did not look like the beginning of a program, thank God. It just looked like the return of the Boogeyman, who has actually already returned. And I thought he was supposed to wrestle this week, but apparently cooler heads prevailed. So that was that.
It was just a wacky little one-shot deal where they could talk about Survivor Series and be wacky and plug their gear and get the Boogeyman on TV, and that was it.
We had Jack Swagger challenging Matt Hardy for an ECW title match, which is a feud I look forward to. That will be fun.
And it makes sense because Swagger came along. He was undefeated for a while beating Geeks. Then he got in a feud with Tommy Dreamer and he beat him handily. And now he's ready for a title shot. So it all makes sense.
Jack Swagger came out and did a promo about how he was an all-American American. He had not been pinned in either college or ECW, and so he wanted Teddy Long to come out right now and name him the number one contender. So Teddy and Tiffany came out, and her existence is fascinating. What in the hell is her job?
I don't know. It can't be to perform because she's so bad at it. But Teddy Swagger was ranting on about how great he was, how he should be top contender. And Tiffany interrupted and said, Teddy, what about Ricky Ortiz?
Teddy, what about Ricky Ortiz?
Yeah.
She's a mannequin brought to life.
So he was like, well, actually, when she mentioned Ortiz and how he was also undefeated, Swagger leaned back, grabbed his belly with both hands, and howled with laughter.
As he should have.
And Teddy ended up saying, you know, that's not a bad idea or whatever. And Swagger said, seriously. Actually, Ortiz came out and made fun of Swagger's lisp.
You know, I never, ever would have noticed Jack Swagger's lisp if Ricky Ortiz not pointed it out.
No, but now everyone's going to notice.
Yeah.
So anyway, Swagger got pissed and said, let me guess, Teddy, you're going to sign us to a match later on tonight to determine the number one contender. Teddy said, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to do it right now. And so we had the match, which was all right. Jack Swagger,
My exact words are, watching Swagger work this geek over equals good times.
Yeah. So Swagger schooled him on the mat a bit, sold for a while, got some heat. There was a completely horrendous comeback by Ortiz. And then he missed the big O. Swagger hit him with a clothesline outside, a doctor bomb in the ring, and it was over. Clean pin. That's the end of the win streak of Ricky Ortiz. Thank Christ. I am a Jack Swagger fan.
Yeah, yeah. He is a lot of fun. He is certainly a better choice than Ricky Ortiz. I will say, most of the horrendous comeback was Ricky Ortiz's fault, but there was a point where Swagger was taking bumps and he just looked goofy. And not in a good, funny, laugh at the heel way, just like a guy who didn't quite know what he was doing yet.
You know, I want to mention something about that promotion that I didn't want to mention here, but I'm going to mention something again, and this is a legitimate statement about what's wrong with that company. There's a reason ECW is the best show on TV right now. And that is not only the fact that it's an hour long, but we have three matches max. The main event is usually long and good. And most of all, we have new fresh faces on this show.
I'll give you a fourth reason. It's simple.
Well, forget all that. The point I'm trying to make is Ricky Ortiz sucks, but he's a fresh face. And, of course, we've got Jack Swagger on there. He's a fresh face. DJ Gabriel is on there. He's a fresh face. All these guys are getting a chance here. We're going to have Mark Henry and Tony Atlas teaming together at the pay-per-view, which is something new. It's going to be horrible, but it's something new at least. Who is in that other company that's fresh? Mick Foley? Yeah, he's just a commentator.
Cute Kip?
No, he's not fresh. He's been there for 4 years.
I'm as cute Kip, though.
Who in that company is, like, new? We've seen the same fucking guys. This is worse than Raw. The same guys over and over and over year after year. They have no developmental.
I would disagree that's the worst thing about it, but that is... But your point is right.
Every Impact is exactly the same, just with different shit.
That is true.
The same guys, the same geeks are in the X Division, the same guys are on top. It's the same thing over and over and over again. ECW is great because it's something new. Jack Swagger's awesome. Thank Christ for Jack Swagger. Thank God for Ricky Ortiz, of all people.
Thank God for DJ Gabriel.
He's wacky. I enjoy Ricky Ortiz. We had Ricky Punk and Kofi against Miz Morrison and Jack Swagger. This is bad.
Well, that's true.
This was... Ricky Ortiz is hideous. I don't know if anyone's noticed that before. And the big thing about this match was Punk immediately, like within the first 5 seconds, started doing his comeback. So whenever that happens, it's like, okay, well, you're not doing the comeback at the end. And so then we had Kofi getting in there. And he got cut off. And I thought, huh. So Punk has made his comeback, and the heat's on Kofi. So if there's a hot tag here, you telling me that the hot tag is going to Ricky O'Reilly here? And the answer was, in fact, yes.
Mm-hmm.
He made a comeback. There was... Dave explained this to me, because I didn't even know this part, but... There was a train wreck outside, a complete train wreck, where somebody tried to do something, and then somebody did a dive, and somebody was out of position, and there was crashing and burning, and apparently this match was heavily edited.
I see.
So, that means that either what they edited was so much worse than this, or this was the worst shit that they couldn't fix. So either way, this was awesome.
All I know about that train wreck spot was there was a point where Kofi Kingston hit a tope to Miz, which is not in and of itself remarkable, but Miz was on his knees at the time and facing like sideways to the ring, which is a poor way to catch a man doing a tope on you.
So anyway, then Ortiz tried to springboard and nearly fell off the ropes, and he was kicked in the gut and root and then hit with the doctor bomb for the pin, and this was quite horrible. So
this is not, yeah, this is a bad ECW.
I also did like at the end, they called Miz Morrison and Swagger the Young Guns. So apparently Ortiz, Kofi, and Punk are either old men or cowboys. Take your pick.
Or Indians.
Or Indians. So one or the other. All right, let's play a song here, and then we'll go to everybody's favorite. We had Matt Hardy against Mark Henry for the... I don't think it was for the ECW title.
Because I've never seen this match before.
The number one contender ran in. So anyway, they had this match, and here was what I found odd about it. First off, it wasn't much of a match. It merely existed. And then at the end, Mark Henry's making a comeback, and that one guy...
Jack Swagger
ran in.
The All-American-American Jack Swagger.
Jack Swagger ran in and laid out Matt with the doctor bomb, and Mark Henry was upset. And I sat there and I thought, why are you mad? The title was on the line, so you couldn't win the belt no matter what happened here. And by having this guy run in, actually, I guess maybe they could have disqualified Mark Henry for this.
They technically did.
Perhaps technically he got DQ'd. But I guess that's a good reason to be mad. But anyway, he was mad, but he still waited for Jack Swagger to leave the ring. And then he gave Matt the big slam. So perhaps they're building a three-way feud. I don't know why. We've seen Matt versus Mark too many times.
Yes.
If Swagger is so bad that they need to put a third man into the feud...
Is Mark Henry the best guy to use?
No. And he's not that bad. So I have no answer as to why they did this right here.
I don't know, yeah. At this point, I don't know what you do with Mark Henry. Because I don't want to see him wrestle Matt anymore. Matt's going to have the belt. And I don't know what
else... Well, maybe not for long.
Perhaps they'll put it back on Mark Henry.
Or perhaps they'll give it to Jack Swagger.
I'd be fine with that.
The number one contender.
I guess my point is, I don't need to see either of these guys wrestle Mark Henry anymore. Perhaps he should go to a different show. Maybe they can...
Well, the Jack Swagger Mark Henry would be new.
Would it be good?
Would Mark Henry versus anyone be good?
I suppose that's a fair point. ECW opened with the All-American-American Jack Swagger versus Fit Finlay. This is a fun little match. Really is quite awesome, especially they started off with your basic chain wrestling stuff. And then after a while, Finlay had enough of this shit, and he opened up the brawling, and it was great. He hit Jack Swagger hard, and Jack Swagger took it and bumped like a man, and it was a lot of fun. Swagger got tossed outside, and Hornswoggle hit a dive off the apron, and this offended Swagger, who did take a bump, by the way. The 6'6", 280-pound man took a bump for the leprechaun. But after that, he got to his feet, and he threw Hornswoggle into the dasher boards hard. He threw him very, very hard into the dasher boards, and so Finlay responded by killing him to death. He beat the fuck out of him for a while. They came back from the break. Finlay's mouth had somehow been busted open. And there was a point here where Swagger got the heat with a boot to the face. And this is how Finlay got busted up. That's right. During the break on the floor, after Finlay killed Swagger, Swagger came back to kill Finlay. He kicked him right in the face. And they showed a slow motion replay of this. And Finlay was taking a big boot out on the floor. And he tried to take this boot with his forehead. And he leaned his forehead into it. And he got kicked in the face really hard. So hard, his head rocketed back. And then the heel of Jack Swagger's boot crushed Finley's nose. And it looked like it sucked. It looked like it sucked. So they were in the ring. Swagger worked him over for a while. Beat him up for a long time. Finlay finally made his comeback. And finally got his receipt when Swagger charged into the corner. And Finlay kicked him with both boots. And they went back and forth for a while. And then Jack Swagger hit his finishing move, the Dr. Bomb, and got the pin. So he is still undefeated. It was his biggest win, they claimed, and which is true. And he has solidified his status as the number one contender. And this was fun pro wrestling here on ECW.
I can't even find my notes.
They also were talking about Jack Swagger's background.
Here we are. Hold
in Greco-Roman wrestling, and which led to this teacher saying that something about how Swagger had never been pinned or never lost in Greco-Roman, and talked about how impressive that was if you knew how long a Greco-Roman season was. And there's a pause. I thought to myself, well, how long is that? And then Todd asked, well, how long is that? And Grissom said, or the teacher said, do your homework. So there you go. I have to go do my homework.
Well, I know that fit is amazing for a 50-year-old man.
That's undoubtedly true.
I think that if Fit and Jack Swagger worked a bunch of matches on the road, Jack Swagger would be great. I have no other notes.
Well, you're right. I agree with everything you said there, so.
Then we had more Jeff Hardy accent footage, and Matt did a promo saying his brother's issues were not going to stop him from performing at the highest level, which apparently they did, by the way, and that he was going to beat Jack Swagger, said that Swagger, he was not an All-American, undefeated like Jack, but he was the champion.
He basically said he will win, and it took him a minute to do so.
And he lost.
And he lied, yes.
By the way, spoiler alert, everybody. If you don't want to hear what happens in the ECW main event, fast forward 5 minutes. With that out of the way, Tommy Dreamer lost the ECW title to Jack Swagger. Seriously.
Matt Hardy.
Whoever. Who'd I say?
Tommy Dreamer.
Tommy Dreamer. Well, he's going to lose, too.
Also a loser.
He lost to Jack Swagger many times. Matt Hardy lost the ECW title to Jack Swagger. They had a very good match. And they've done I think everybody knows the finish by now since we spoiled it on the other show. But Matt went for a power bomb, and Swagger tore off the top turnbuckle in the middle of the spot, which was actually really cool the way it set up the finish. And then dropped Matt over the buckle, gave him the doctor bomb for the pin. They've noted that nobody's ever kicked out of the doctor bomb, which is pretty cool. And I guess the whole point of this is they did a perfect job with Jack Swagger.
Mm-hmm.
He debuted. He didn't lose any matches on TV. They billed him as undefeated. He started working his way up the ladder. He beat higher and higher profile guys. He beat Fit Finley clean. He demanded a title shot, and he beat the champion, I guess as clean as you're going to get in WWE. And now he's the champion. And I was watching this, and I thought, this is why ECW is great. Because in ECW, they don't give a shit about anybody in this company, in this brand. It doesn't matter to them if Fit Finley does a clean job. It doesn't matter to them if Matt Hardy does a clean job.
Yeah.
It's not about making sure that everybody is at the same level in ECW.
You don't need to protect everyone.
No one has to be protected. Whereas Raw and SmackDown, they're deathly afraid of any of the top guys doing any clean jobs or putting anybody over clean. And that's why on Raw and SmackDown, nobody ever gets over.
You can't have Orton pin Kane. Have Kane get a shoulder up and the ref won't see it.
Meanwhile, on ECW, Jack Swagger just goes on a rampage and beats everybody.
Yes.
And now he's over.
Right.
Now he's the fucking champion. They made a star.
Yeah.
It's so fucking easy. But they're terrified to do this on the other two shows.
Indeed. It helps, by the way, that Jack Swagger is pretty goddamn good. Jack Swagger with the heat on anyone and beating up, for example, Matt Hardy for an extended period of time, good TV. And as you noted, they set up the finish about 10 minutes before they actually paid it off with the turnbuckle pad coming off. And then they wrestled, and this match went a good 15, 20 minutes. And by the end, they were still going a very fast pace and doing just fine. So, giant thumbs up for both these men and everyone involved.
We had Henry and Jack Swagger against Matt Hardy and Fit Finley, which was a pretty fun little match. And Matt ended up pinning Swagger with the Twist of Fate. Thumbs down to the finish. I realize,
oh, hell yeah.
I realize they're building up a pay-per-view, but he just won the belt. He got pinned the first fucking match.
He just won the belt, and it was his first pin ever. First time he was pinned just by Matt in a meaningless tag
match. You
know
what this is? We talked about this last week. It's people petrified to have people lose on Raw and SmackDown. You really couldn't just have Jack Swagger beat Matt Hardy again. Seriously.
Or Finley.
Matt.
Either one, but
just have him keep beating the guy.
The worst by guy to get pinned is who they picked. There's no reason to have Jack Swagger get pinned here. I did like a point. They did the most basic hot tag tease ever here. Where I think it was, I forget who it was. Somebody, they had the heat of Finley, and had him in a front face lock, and he was inching his way towards the corner, reaching out, step by step, getting closer and closer, until finally the guy just turned around and punched Matt in the face. That made me laugh.
We gotta get crack-a-lackin' here. ECW here tonight. Todd Grisham interviewed Matt about his brother being blown to smithereens. And he said Jeff was at home recovering. He'd gone into shock, suffering from first-degree burns. Todd wanted to know if this was...
He actually said he had suffered first-degree burns, quote, due to all the explosions.
Sure.
Which amused me for reasons I can't fathom. But
you're still not healed?
I actually just popped a cough drop before we started.
Christ,
too.
Dude. Yeah. Anyway, so Matt said he was going to shoot straight. It was no accident. And anyway, out came Swagger after they plugged the Matt versus Swagger match at the pay-per-view. And Matt said Swagger was better than he thought he was, but this Sunday he was going to beat him. And of course, Swagger said, no, this Sunday is a formality. I will beat you and become the new face of this franchise. And he said if Matt thought that he could take the title from him, then just like his brother, Matt would go down in flames. This was a major burn, so to speak.
Oh, I see what you did there.
And Matt punched him in the face and then chased him out on the ramp and double-legged him. Yes, he double-legged the All-American All-American. Bullshit. But it happened. The referees pulled him apart. Swagger got a cheap shot in there. And this was the final segment, you know? It was fine.
It was.
It just was fine.
Exactly. My favorite part of this actually happened right beforehand. The show opened with a video of Jack Swagger basically recapping his title win from last week, but also just sort of random shots of him looking cool, including a shot of him in his gear standing before a stairwell, and at the top of the stairwell was a great stained glass window. I just love, what universe was this in where they just said, Jack, stand in front of this stained glass window and look cool?
Who knows?
I don't know.
Jack Swagger and Matt Hardy for the ECW title, which Matt Hardy lost after getting hit with the doctor bomb. And he looked very sad about this, and so sad that you knew trouble was coming. And match was a good little match for what it was, and I was glad Jack Swagger got the win back after being beaten on SmackDown for absolutely no good reason.
It was said in the room watching this, this is good, but I could be watching it on ECW, which I guess is technically true. This is as good as your average ECW main event match these days, but isn't that more a compliment about how good ECW has gotten? That there's a good, decent amount of time match every single week on a show?
Mark, do you watch ECW but, these days?
No.
No. It's actually not bad these days.
No. I'm not going to watch ECW, Brian.
But come on, this is like the end of Tommy Dreamer's career coming up.
I don't give a fuck. His career should have been over a long time ago.
Don't think of an ECW.
Wrestling in that fucking fake ECW ring.
Just think of it as the Tuesday night wrestling show.
I was thinking about it the other day. I was like, you know what, maybe I should just get over it, you know, the whole ECW thing, because, you know, we all knew it wasn't going to be the same when they brought it back.
Sure.
But just hearing you guys say nice things about it just makes me want to fucking kill you guys. What the fuck?
Wow.
What are you talking about?
Why don't we call it velocity when we speak of it?
I don't want to kill you guys.
Let's call it velocity. How about that?
I don't want to be killed.
What did you think about Jack Swagger versus Matt Hardy for the Velocity title?
I don't even know who Jack Swagger is.
Wow.
The whole time that match was going on, I was like, oh, Fat Hardy's fighting some dude. Great.
Fat Hardy.
Like, who gives a fuck about these people?
Fat Hardy, you say?
Yeah, Fat Hardy. The fat one. That dude's a fucking loser. Like, I have no idea why they ever put a belt on that fucking guy.
Wow. So we had Jack Swagger come out and said that he was going to have his official title celebration tonight, I believe like 3 weeks after he won the belt.
Yeah, so, and has defended it several times.
Pacing himself here. And so they started playing his music, and then Boogie appeared and started gyrating. And somehow this led to Boogie against Ricky Ortiz.
Stop! Boogeyman in a wrestling match with Ricky Ortiz.
Yeah.
No tag partners, no stipulations. No, nothing to hide the action that would be Boogeyman wrestling Ricky Ortiz.
Well, there was. Boogie clotheslined him over the top, Ortiz ran away, and they played Boogie's music again.
And by the way, in that 6 seconds of action, it sucked!
Yeah.
Horrible idea! Ungodly bad idea!
Yeah.
And they're gonna do it again!
Okay, who could they put Boogeyman with, Vince? It would not be a bad idea.
They should cut both these guys.
Alright. We had Teddy on the phone talking to somebody, and then Swagger walked in and said he had a problem. Someone stole his ECW championship, I guess he said. They can't say belt.
They can no longer say belt.
Or strap.
Which I think that's been the rule for a while, but yes, they cannot say belt.
Said the celebration was coming up, and he wanted to know what Teddy was going to do, and Teddy said nothing. but go ask Tiffany. She'll help you. And okay.
So he did.
We had Tiffany flirting with Ortiz, and Swagger came up and dragged her away to look for the belt. And they found Mark Henry and asked if he'd seen it, and he was insulted.
He emasculated Swagger, just dressed him down, and Swagger backed down.
Basically said, if I did, what are you going to do about it? And Swagger, the champion, mind you, had no answer.
Mm. By the way.
Way to go, buddy. So then Swagger and Tiffany met with Teddy and said they hadn't found it, so what were they going to do about it? And Teddy said, well, let's go to the ring and I'll get it back. After all that, he couldn't just do this earlier. And by the way, if we look at this as if the show is real, I guess the main event was Dreamer and Henry, and they had nothing to close the show with.
No. Dreamer and Henry began, and I was going down the rosters, like, with Matt gone, I don't think Miz and Morrison are on the show, and if they are, they have no one to wrestle. This is going to be the main event, and there are 18 minutes left, and I was petrified. And thankfully, it only went six, but I was like, what the hell are they going to do now?
So anyway, the main event was them coming out, and it turns out the Midget had the belt, and Finley punched out Swagger. And that was the end. This show sucked. I don't feel the need to devote any more time to this program. This was horrible.
I must point out one more thing. Teddy and Tiffany and Jack Swagger were standing in the ring, and Teddy was demanding that he come out and return the belt right now, and nothing happened for a while. And Jack Swagger grabbed the microphone and declared, "This is lame!" And I thought, it is! It is lame, Jack! Your show is lame now! Yeah, so the other casualty in the stupid turn of Matt Hardy was all of ECW.
God, what a bad show. This show used to be fun. Now it, like, sucks.
So 1 week. 1 week from being fun to shitty.
There's no reason to watch this program, by the way. But I guess I still have to. Jack Swagger did a promo about the main event, and as everyone knows, he has a lisp. And I guess it doesn't really bother me. It doesn't bother me. Actually, you know what? It does bother me. I think he's going to be fine even with the lisp. But whenever he talks right into the camera, you just can't help but look at his tongue running into his teeth every time he tries to talk. It's very distracting.
It was distracting for me here, too. And I've noted this earlier that someone was making fun of his lisp, and I thought that was stupid because I never would have noticed if they hadn't pointed
it out. Ricky Ortiz.
It was Ricky Ortiz. That's fine. But, yeah, watching this promo, I'm pretty sure I would have noticed it immediately. It was pretty evident here.
We had Jack Swagger and Finley in the main event, and they had a really good match. And ended up with Swagger. He got the heat, and then he took the shillelagh and tossed it so that it would even the odds. But, of course, the odds were not even, as the Midget had a shillelagh of his own.
It was actually a much bigger stick.
I wasn't sure if it was or just because the Midget's so small.
Oh, maybe that's it.
I was trying to figure
bigger,
this out.
Yeah.
May have just been an optical illusion. But, anyway, he whacked Jack in the leg, and then Fitley hit the clothesline and the Celtic cross for the pin. And, you know, I got to say, it's rare that I put Todd Grisham over. But Todd Grisham's reaction to the Celtic cross and the fact that Jack Swagger finally got pinned, he actually did a hell of a job. I got to give him credit.
Todd Grisham here was like Michael Cole calling CM Punk's world title win.
Except he was actually good.
Well, except for that, I guess.
I don't think I've ever seen a moment where Cole has been good. So that
was
a show.
Referring to their relative enthusiasm level.
No, he actually was very enthusiastic here.
No, that's what I'm saying. But He was that excited for this match, which was just a guy winning a non-title match versus Cole's reaction to the same enthusiasm level for a guy winning the world title when no one knew he'd be getting the shot 5 minutes prior.
Yeah. Cole sucks, everyone.
Yeah.
Just thought I'd throw that out there. So anyway, that was the show. Not much to it.
It was much better than last week.
Grab some presents.
All right.
There you go. ECW opened up with Jack Swagger coming out. Very unhappy. And he talked about how he'd been victimized and embarrassed for the last 2 weeks by Finley and his son. And Teddy's solution was to book him in a match with Finley at the pay-per-view. And he said this was unfair. He was a victim. He wasn't going to wait until the pay-per-view. He was going to deal with the bullshit right now. He demanded Hornswoggle come out and face him like a man. And who should come out but another midget, another skinny man, Christian Cage.
He's not a midget. He is skinny, but he is no midget.
Out in the ring, and they're still calling him Captain Charisma. Stryker noted he hadn't seen him in 3 years, but that was pretty much all they said about that. And crowd chanted Christian. This came off, I thought, better than it sounded from reading the reports online. People seemed to indicate that he had no reaction, but that wasn't true. It wasn't like a Ric Flair in Greenville reaction or anything, but it was fine. He made fun of Swagger for his lisp and buried TNA by saying, "It's been a long time since my peeps have seen me." That was funny. And then basically challenged the winner of the match on Sunday to a title match down the road. And Swagger said, "Well, that will be me." And they had an argument. And then Christian hit him with the mic. And Swagger held his head and went, "Arr!" And that was the segment right there.
Yes, by and large, this was not nearly as bad as we buried it on Monday, hearing the news, not having seen it. My only really complaint here is, you know, it's all set up perfectly because Jack Swagger calls out Hornswoggle, so everyone turns to the stage. The camera turns to the stage, and here's the video. Here's the new music. Out walks Christian, and he's getting a good reaction. And then Todd Grisham says, and I quote, "It's Christian." And then Mike Stryker says something like, "We've just gone instantly classic." Just a completely wacky catchphrase, cued and ready. Both those guys suck to this point.
Yeah.
It was just no good. If they had the opportunity to redo this entrance 100 times, it would have been better.
Then we had the main event, which was Christian and Jack Swagger. And they had a fun little match right here. And big comeback there at the end. Finley did commentary, as did Hornswoggle, who just grunted. And Finley had this great line during the comeback where he said, "All these big moves are great, yes, but you got to pin the guy."
He had two awesome lines, and I've critiqued his promos and his speaking ability before for his ability to say interesting things. But there was that line where Christian was making his comeback, getting all these giant moves, and Finley said, "Yeah, see, all these big moves are great, but you know, you got to pin the guy," and he basically saying, "Christian, go for a cover, make it look real." And he had a line before that where they were recapping how he and Hornswoggle had been tormenting Jack Swagger and stealing his belt and embarrassing him. And there was a brief pause, then Finley just says, "My heart bleeds for him," and just moved on. That was great. And speaking of great lines on commentary, there's a point in this match where Jack Swagger picked up Christian and pressed him over his head and dropped him over the ropes to the arena floor. A big spot. We've seen it before. Matt Stryker then claimed, "Jack Swagger is more than 6 feet tall. The ring is 9 feet high. That was a 15-foot drop."
Well, bad math.
A lie, this. This was a lie.
Let's play a song here. Oh, we actually didn't. Hold on. We might as well talk about the finish.
Christian won after the Irish interfered.
Yeah, the Finley interfered and hit Swagger with a shillelagh, and Christian got the pin. And I really actually don't need to talk about this too much because Dave and I dissected this for hours the other night, so you can listen to that show. But suffice to say, this could have been done better.
Sure.
Christian could have
won.
Well,
or he could have beaten somebody else, or
he could have not fucking wrestled this week. There
he
were
could
a lot,
have not
of,
wrestled this
lot
week.
Of options better than this one.
Sure, but there was one other great line here by Finley where they teased the old Kurt Angle spot where from the apron, Jack Swagger teased a German suplex from the apron to the floor, and Christian hung onto the ropes to save his life. And Finley, very calmly, very casually said, "A suplex off here. That might hurt."
Yeah.
He was awesome.
All right, let's play this song now, and then we'll get our guest on the line.
I did like the sign the fan had that said, "Batista, shake them ropes." And that poor fan, now that I think about it, never got to see Dave shake the ropes.
That should be a shirt. I like it when you shake them ropes.
Watch yourself!
Shake them ropes.
Show me what you're working for.
Shake them ropes.
Watch yourself.
Shake them ropes.
I came here with my dick in my hand. So maybe
Yakuza kick him in the ass.
Be cool.
Shake them ropes.
Watch yourself.
Shake them ropes.
Show me what you're working for.
Shake them ropes.
Watch yourself.
Shake them ropes. Anybody who thinks that we're bad on this show as far as being good radio hosts, you ain't seen nothing yet. That's a great song. Jack Swagger and Fit Finley for the ECW title. A failure of a match. Swagger won. I gave it a star just because, I don't know why, actually. Because
why not?
They were better than Kozlov. But no one in the entire building cared one iota about this match. The children, who were all excited to see Hornswoggle, didn't even care once the match started. And then the match ended, and people were overjoyed.
Yeah, a large part of it is because of the position of the match. We had already seen the big giant chamber match for the WWE title, followed by the Anything Goes match, which featured guys getting hit in the head with TV monitors and bodies flying through tables. And then here were two men exchanging holds. Fail. Complete fail. And there was a bit where Hornswoggle came out, and this distracted Finley, and no one cared about that. And yeah, as I texted you, I was sitting to my left and behind me were some of the most annoying fans I've ever seen in my life. But to my right was a bunch of 10 and 11-year-old kids who thought that because this is a pay-per-view, that meant they were fighting for real. And these kids were awesome. I love these children. And they were very excited to see Hornswoggle, who came out with Finley and then immediately dove under the ring, and they stopped caring.
Henry and Swagger against Christian and Finley. Very basic match early. The highlight of this was when the announcer said that Christian had chosen ECW.
Right.
This was the only brand he wanted to go to. Yeah. He didn't want to go to Raw.
Well, Brian, it's important to know that all those internet rumor spreaders were wrong when they said he'd show up on SmackDown.
Oh.
That was the key to all this.
Wow.
There was a point here where I don't know. I watched it twice. I have no idea what Stryker and Grisham said, but they said something bad. And they went silent for like 3 seconds, and the camera cut to a shot where you could see them in the background. And they're not speaking, and suddenly Grisham just kind of throws up his hands, and Stryker gives the most awkward smile ever, and then they continued. I don't know what they said, but they said something wrong, and they got yelled at, and it was great.
Yes. Then Atlas tried to interfere, was thwarted, and then I gave up on the match because it became TNA. We had a million people in the ring, right in front of the ref, including the midget. None of this was an EQ. A bunch of dudes hit each other, and finally Christian hit Swagger with the Unprettier for the pin. Last week, for those of you that read the newsletter, for those of you that are good people, I wrote that Christian's very presence on ECW had made the show worth watching. It has exactly been 1 week, and I was wrong.
He is just another guy.
My God, is he just another guy. He's just another guy. So this show sucked.
Yeah, there's nothing special here.
Swagger and Christian next week for the title. A week ago, I would have cared. This week, I could not possibly care less.
He killed your interest. That's the opposite of what the show is supposed to do, though,
the
right?
The show was still better than Impact.
Oh, by miles. Miles and miles and miles.
Yeah.
Yeah, the only other thing I really have to note is that, well, first of all, a question. How come Shelton Benjamin can't wrestle like Jack Swagger can? I don't know. I understand Jack Swagger is a better amateur background, but...
Jack Swagger?
Wasn't he the NCAA champion?
Jesus Christ. Shelton Benjamin used to school the shit out of Brock Lesnar.
Well, then, okay, I'll stand by my question more. Why can't Shelton Benjamin do this shit?
I don't know, because Shelton Benjamin is no good at this business, apparently.
I guess not.
He's certainly not any good at promos.
I would also like to
congratulate... I'm full of hate for just everything today.
I would like to congratulate Matt Stryker for getting references to Dawkins and Wolverine in this match. So, way to go, Matt.
What a dork. Yeah, Jack Swagger and Christian for the ECW title, which was a great fucking match. And they went a long-ass time, like 20 minutes, I think. And Christian did a great job with him, and Swagger is getting better every week. And long heat segment with Christian getting his shoulder worked over, and Swagger was awesome. And then Christian made a great comeback, and they had a bunch of great near falls. And finally, Swagger went for his Dr. Bomb, but Christian slipped out and went for the Unprettier, which they've given some new name to.
The Kill Switch.
Yeah, whatever. Anyway, unfortunately for him, his bad arm gave out, and Swagger immediately hit his finisher for the pin, and that was that. This was two thumbs up.
This was tremendous. It did go 20 minutes. I did time it. They were listing various titles that Christian had won in his career. Oddly, the TNA world title did not surface in this discussion. In fact, a few minutes later, they noted that he had been on hiatus for 3 years. So they officially claimed that TNA does not exist in the world on television. That was awesome. Then the, what other wacky things did they say? Matt Stryker made, I think, the nerdiest comment ever on a WWE show when he was listing great battles to compare this to, like Rocky Balboa versus Apollo Creed. Then he compared this to, and Brian, I don't think you'll get this reference, but he compared them to Ryu and Ken.
Is this a Kaiju Big Battle?
No.
Oh.
This is Street Fighter 2.
Oh, yeah, way
like
over my head.
From 1993.
Way over my head.
Which Matt Stryker and his buddies no doubt played late in the evening in their Super Nintendos in their dorms.
I'm sure they did.
So that was impressive. Jack Swagger, yes, he's quite great. He's doing cool new moves this week, including, I believe, the WWE debut of the Gator Roll from UFC and Pride. He also had a leg-hooking Northern Light Suplex that was quite awesome. And then they just had a very great 20-minute match. So... we really didn't skip anything here. There's a brief video mentioning that Kane will be on ECW next week for some reason. And that's it, folks. It was a one-hour show, four matches, two squashes, one short, one long, and great. So that was all you need to do for an hour of wrestling fun.
Finally, we had Miz Morrison and Swagger against Christian Finlay and Tommy Dreamer. They had a good match, and in some places it was really good. Christian actually looked great. Morrison looked great. I was talking on the Daily Show today. We were talking about WrestleMania matches and how, you know, with Hunter and Orton, it's not like these are two great workers we've never seen in the ring and we're wondering what awesome stuff they're going to pull out. We know exactly what's going to happen with Hunter and Orton. They're going to have a really good match. Someone's going to win. It's not like, for example, Miz and Morrison against Ray and Evan Bourne, which you think of the ideas that these guys could do together, and you get excited. And I was noting that there aren't any matches like that at WrestleMania at this point. And
I'm I disagree. I can't wait to see what Kane and Mark Henry do with ladders.
Well, there is that. But anyway, the idea of Jack Swagger, I'm sorry, Christian and John Morrison having a match, that excites me. That could be a great singles match right there. But anyway, they had a little match here, and at the end, Christian hit the kill switch, but Swagger had made the blind tag and quickly hit the doctor bomb for the pin. And after the great match, I was just left thinking, what was the point of that?
Now, by the point of that, do you mean that match or the entire program?
Well, just the idea that this was not a blow-off match.
No.
It was a six-man tag.
Right.
So if it's not the blow-off match, why did the champion win?
To make sure...
It sets up nothing.
To make sure there are no viable contenders that we'd be interested in seeing him wrestle, apparently.
Shouldn't a match either be a blow-off or set something up?
You would think if you want...
This doesn't even continue the storyline.
No.
Christian lost in the title match, yeah. And then he lost to the champion again the next week in a six-man.
Yes.
There's no way we could possibly care about Christian challenging again.
Moreover, they don't have anyone interesting for him to...
Sets up no challengers.
No.
I don't know why I'm overanalyzing this, but I remember watching and just thinking, why did Jack Swagger pin Christian again? What was the point?
There were six men in this match. They could have done however many combinations. That may have been the worst one to choose. But yes, we have said many times, the main event of every WWE show should be a six-man tag. They're almost always fun. This is no exception. My favorite striker line, which now has to be like a category on this, but he blatantly said that Tommy Dreamer, Fit Finlay, and Christian were the fan favorites. And Jack Swagger and Miz Morrison were the rule breakers.
Yeah.
He's reading his PWI.
And Swagger came out and did a promo saying, hi. That was essentially it.
Well, he said, I'm good looking.
Yeah. He said, I wasn't on last week's show. I'm not on this week's show. So I'm going to come out and let you all look at me because I'm hot. Then we had the Jack Swagger and Tyson Kidd against Tommy Dreamer and Evan Bourne match. I would like to see Tyson and Evan wrestle for... 100 years together.
Yes, indeed.
Throw Jamie Noble in there. That's fine as well. And ended up with... it was kind of odd because... what's his name? Evan Bourne got the hot tag. And it went like 5 seconds. And then he won. All right. I realize this is the second match back. And you don't really want to put the brakes on him after just 2 weeks. But at the same time, I don't understand why... Evan Bourne pinned Tyson Kidd in their first tag match together. I always kind of thought the idea was you get some heat. But feud's over, but somehow it's going to continue.
Well, Tyson Kidd can say, hey, now that was in a tag team match. You have not yet to beat me one-on-one.
Why not just pin Tommy Dreamer?
I don't have an answer to that question. Tommy Dreamer is always a good option to be pinned. A perfectly fine option, yes. We've compared Tyson Kidd has been compared to Dynamite Kidd. He came up as part of the Stampede Bulldogs, where, of course, Harry Smith was Davey Boy, so Tyson was Dynamite Kid by default. And if he's the Dynamite Kid, then goddammit, he has found his tiger mask, because the Tyson Kid, Evan Bourne stuff was so awesome. And everything else was fine. Matt Stryker was phenomenal on commentary, putting Evan Bourne over as an important thing. They also began to discuss Swagger facts, which apparently come from the website, where basically Jack Swagger puts out facts about himself, like what he can bench and what his 40 time is. And I had a sudden urge to watch the entire WWE roster take turns doing the 40-yard dash. Can you imagine Tommy Dreamer running 40 yards?
Triple H,
the great Khali. I would pay to see this.
Khali would take two strides.
Well, great. That'd be fun. I would pay more to see that than I would for WrestleMania.
How about the Midget? They should put the Midget and Great Khali in a 40-yard dash. That might be fair.
Him.
I don't know.
Oh, the Midget would destroy. Are you kidding me?
Well, you'd have to take 42 steps to match one stride.
Yes.
I bet the Great Khali walking might be faster than the Midget running.
I bet not.
We'll find out.
Big Show, maybe.
Swagger met with Cena. Cena buried him. He made fun of his gimmick. He called him a punk kid with a few wins under his belt. The ECW champion, mind you. Stupid.
Well, of course, his championship is so prestigious, he was not even mentioned on WrestleMania. So, yeah, and they don't want you to care about him at all. So, yes, they buried their own product even more.
Cena and Swagger, champion versus champion. They actually got a long time. It was actually a pretty damn good match. Cena gave him all sorts of shit and then finally pinned him with the FU and the STFU, so it was a submission. But Cena's facials were awesome in that he sold it like, My God, this young upstart with only a couple of wins under his belt gave me a run for my money. I have a newfound respect for him.
Indeed.
This was good. This was the first good thing on the show.
Except for the
DDT. Kelly's pants.
Except for the DDT spot.
Well, there was that.
Jack Swagger tried to float over DDT, and he tried to land on his feet, and Cena tried to go straight down on the mat, and then they struggled. And Cena basically tried to take Swagger down legit. It was bad.
Then we had Tiffany coming out to introduce Christian and Swagger for the contracts. And yes, the show's already almost over.
Yes.
She is so comically horrible at this
job. She's so wooden. This is where I fell in love with her, because she is trying so hard. Remember when our pal Phoebe was the ring announcer for ICW?
Yes.
And she would walk around the halls word for word, "This contest is scheduled for one fall." Tiffany has clearly done the same thing. When she said the word opportunity and broke it down into five words, opportunity.
You will also have the opportunity to make any final comments.
And,
I don't believe a single word that comes out of her mouth.
Oh, no, not at all.
Including, my name is Tiffany.
No, she's ridiculously wooden and phony and bad, but she's trying so hard that I love her.
I don't. Stop trying so hard, for Christ's sake. So Christian and Swagger came out, and Swagger, of course, is decked to the nines. Christian is wearing a jeans and a t-shirt, which I guess that's his gimmick, that he's casual. But in jeans and a t-shirt, he looks 145 pounds.
Well, in his wrestling gear, he looks 135, so.
He's tiny. No, he looks way smaller in street clothes. In gear, he actually looks, I'd say in gear, he looks about 185. In street clothes, maybe 165.
Okay.
He's tiny.
So especially next to the giant that is Jack Swagger, who I knew was very tall, but I'm watching these two guys at the table together, and his head is enormous.
Yes. He's a large man.
Yeah.
Well, Christian's head is small, because he's a small man.
Actually, Christian's an average-sized man.
No, he's small. Vinny, you're 240 pounds. You're twice the size of Christian. He's an ECW superstar and perhaps champion.
He's
far below average.
He's of average height.
Maybe.
He is very skinny. That'll grant you.
So Swagger came out and they argued back and forth. Actually, they didn't. Swagger did all the talking and finally wanted to know, why aren't you saying anything? So Christian said some stuff. And then said, well, you know, I don't need to say anything. I'll do my talking in the ring. And he also made fun of the suit, the stupid haircut, and the speech impediment, by the way. And so Swagger ended up blindsiding him and then giving him the doctor bomb through the table. And let me tell you something, everybody. I love the teacher. I love Josh Matthews. I'm glad they're the commentators for this show. But they were so horrible during this segment. Like, I thought Tiffany was bad. She, at least, we know is bad, okay? I think that Josh Matthews and the teacher are good, but go back and watch this segment and listen to them react to this post-match or this post-signing beatdown. I don't know if either man raised his voice. They recited word for word whatever it was that Vince had told them over the headset with no passion whatsoever.
I believe you.
This angle was not bad, but they sold it in such a manner that you could not possibly care.
I guess if I had not seen this exact same thing done 7,000 times, maybe I would not think it was that bad. But after Tiffany stopped, I thought, this is boring. This is lame. I know exactly what's going to happen. It happened exactly like I thought it would. I cared about it less afterwards than
before.
But
Jim Ross would have at least attempted to make
tried.
You care.
I don't disagree.
You would have believed that Jim Ross was appalled at this behavior.
For that matter, Don West and Mike Tenay would have tried.
Don West and Mike Tenay. Mike Hogwood. Can you imagine if Mike Hogwood would have seen this, the reaction he would have had to the temerity
he
of
would
Jack
have
Swagger.
Had an aneurysm, actually, while they're live on the air.
Yes.
Yes, and yes. But the teacher and Josh Matthews were just as... They know wrestling, and so they are just as bored as I was. And they could not fake it.
I wish I had a drop of this. I mean, I've buried Michael Cole. I got to call a spade here. I have buried Michael Cole. But I would have preferred Michael Cole here, believe it or not. Michael Cole would have at least faked passion.
He would have screamed, vintage contract signing.
These guys basically faked. They didn't even fake.
No, they were completely indifferent and they didn't care who knew.
I
they did
even
not
say,
give a shit.
I can't even say they feigned boredom.
They half-assed it. They quarter-assed it.
This was horrible.
They non-assed it.
These guys were horrible here. So, anyway,
that was ECW, everyone.
That was ECW.
An hour of our lives.
Someone send me the drop of that last couple of minutes, so I got to play it here on the air for those people that don't watch ECW, just so you could listen to this and just be in awe of two people that could not possibly give a shit less about the ECW go-home angle for their title match on the fucking pay-per-view. It was incredible. That I lost my train of thought.
Okay. Show opened with Christian versus Jack Swagger for the ECW Championship. It was very good. I don't know if it's them letting Jack Swagger or if Swagger takes it upon himself, but whereas Shelton Benjamin has a great amateur background, but he pretty much wrestles like a normal pro wrestler, Jack Swagger has worked in lots of amateur stuff into his style. He'll do things like do an amateur style shoot in and then turn into a backdrop, for example, and stuff like that. And so he was doing all these great amateur things that looked really awesome because he's a huge monster. And then Christian would counter with his standard pro wrestling stuff, and it made for a contrast of styles. Swagger got the heat by pressing Christian over his head and dropping him on the floor. A phenomenally stupid thing to do. And for a smart guy, Christian still does stupid stuff like this fairly regularly. But the crowd was totally into it. And let's see what happened here. Swagger hit a top rope Vader bomb for a near fall at one point. And the finish was also really cool. After Christian made his comeback, Swagger went to yank off a turnbuckle pad, but the referee caught him. And so while the referee was dealing with that, Christian yanked off the opposite turnbuckle pad. And so Swagger charged him, and Christian dodged, and Swagger ran on the turnbuckle and got hit with the kill switch and got pinned. He was out-cheated by the Wily veteran. This is good stuff.
I remember what I was going to say now. The Randy Orton world title match, or whatever it was, what is it?
They're the WWE.
Is it the WWE or
Randy Orton has the WWE title.
All right. So he's been the WWE World Heavyweight Champion one time and the WWE Championship three times. I'm going to have to see when he won these titles. When did he last...
You know what? I think I can name these off the top of my head. The world title he won from Benoit 2004. Then he won... I forget exactly what happened, but the WWE Championship was vacant.
Okay, it was that one night where
he was
got
a named champion and then lost to Hunter and won it back the same show.
All right.
Yeah.
See, this is what annoys me. They were talking, and Orton's doing this interview, like he'd finally achieved his title win after 5 years from Hunter.
Are you talking about Raw now?
Yeah.
Okay.
But it doesn't matter.
That's fine.
But it's like, you know, I thought, you're telling me this guy hasn't been the champion since 2004? I find that impossible to believe. And, of course, it was impossible to believe, because as I look at this thing now, it's true. He had the title for, let's see, October,
like
November, December,
time.
January, February, March, April. 6 months!
Yeah.
So, I don't know which is worse. The fact that I forgot 6 months, or that they ignored 6 months. Which is worse?
Probably that they ignored it.
All right. Well, there you go. Yeah, it was a good match. I gave it 3.5 stars.
That sounds just about right. Afterwards... Okay, I still call him Cage. He was on TNA for years. Christian walked backstage, and he was met by the ECW fan favorites, which consisted of Finley, Tommy Dreamer, and Evan Bourne. They congratulated him, said, way to go, champ. Then he ran with his old buddy Edge, who I don't know if they're still supposed to be brothers or not, but Christian ran up, and long story short, Christian said, hey, Edge, you used to be fun. Now you're not. And Edge said, well, wait till I win my title back, because John Cena ruined my life, and I'll get my belt back, and then I'll be fun again. And it was, I guess, notable because it was the first time, really the first time they've even acknowledged their history in the couple of months Christian's been back. And, you know, I don't think the majority of the audience is that into it. I think the majority of the audience is into Cena and maybe Triple H and maybe Undertaker, and that's about it. But for the people who are into Christian and Edge, they are clearly dying to see this. So they want to see this continue, and I suspect they'll do a slow build to something.
All right, then we add, what do we have? The interview with Swagger, where they sent Josh Matthews out there to interview him. And this was the polar opposite of WEC, where Frank Mir interviews 135-pounders. And Swagger basically, Josh wanted to know, why did you interfere in the Christian-Tommy Dreamer match last week? Because you're getting a shot in the next pay-per-view, so who gives a fuck who the champion is? And Swagger said, well, I have a bigger problem with Christian than with Dreamer. But then he proceeded to bury Dreamer, calling him the fat and cholesterol of ECW as opposed to the heart and soul, and talked about how he was going to retire in 5 weeks. And Dream ended up hitting the row, or hitting the ring and attacking him, and in a very comical manner, Swagger bailed and flapped his wings and spun around and screamed about his suit. And I'm thinking we may get a three-way bout at the pay-per-view, but I'm not sure.
And frankly, I don't really care. But it was, I don't know. Josh came out, Josh's tie, he was wearing this amazing purple tie with circles on it. It was spectacularly dorky. I don't know where he found this, but I got to get one. But Swagger came out, he was bragging about his three-month title reign. Like this was an era that had ended when his title was stolen. This glorious 90-some-odd days when he was champion. That was silly. He called Dreamer fat, as you noted. He also called him Fatty Dreamer. And I have to say that this is why we need guys with different body types in wrestling. They can't all be bodybuilders. You got to have at least one pudgy guy in the roster so you can call him Fatty. You need to have a fatty on every show. That's very important. And finally, I don't know if it's just Swagger's funky body or if it's just a cheap suit, but I've never seen a guy who looks so bad wearing a suit. It just looks wrong on him. Get him a good one.
Who,
folks.
Jack Swagger?
Yeah.
No, that's half of the greatness of it.
It hangs loosely off him.
Sure. Look at how fucking gigantic Jack Swagger is. Where did they possibly find a suit that hung on him?
Oh, didn't you put it that way? It should have gone all the way. It should
the
have
Giantism
been,
store?
It should have been too short on his sleeves and the legs, so his ankles and wrists were showing. You're still typing.
I'm sending a message to Caden right now.
I hope you're using the word fuck.
Why am I not on the TCW roster page? Gravely offended. And I have put a frowning one of those faces.
So you mean business.
I do mean business. I'm also going to mention the fact that when I plugged that last match, we got 1,300 views in 12 hours. I deserve some type of credit for that. God damn it. So anyway, I've sent him that little message right there. We'll see what he says. Then we had Hurricane interviewed Mark Henry, who was covered with water. That led to Christian versus Henry. This went about 2 minutes before Swagger hit the ring. And then we got Tiffany.
Yes, we did.
For those of you that are not listening to Wrestling Observer Radio yet, which is probably only Vince, you need to go and listen to it for, I swear to God, Dave ranted for 15 fucking minutes about Tiffany. Like 15 minutes.
She was really, really bad this week.
I'm going to read exactly what she said. Since Christian and Mark Henry have been joined by Jack Swagger and Tommy Dreamer, then I say let's have a tag team match. And I say let's have it right now. Now, I'm going to try and say it like she said it. I don't even know if I can do this. Since Christian and Mark Henry have been joined by Jack Swagger and Tommy Dreamer, then I say let's have a tag team match. And I say, let's have it right now.
You're on the right track.
Since Christian and Mark Henry have been joined by Jack Swagger and Tommy Dreamer, then I say, let's have a tag team match. And I say, let's have it right now.
I bet I could even do better. Hold on, let me try again.
You need some water or anything?
No, actually, well, I'm going to try it without it. All right, here we go. Since Christian and Mark Henry have been joined by Jack Swagger and Tommy Dreamer, then I say, let's have a tag team match. And I say, let's have it right now.
You are getting better with the practice. After five or six more of these, you may have it down.
Now, the problem is, I'm going to do one more, and I'm going to do this completely over the top. I need to take a deep breath here. And I need to try and do it with a huge
arms
smile.
Arms over your head so you can get all that air in your lungs.
Since Christian and Mark Henry have been joined by Jack Swagger and Tommy Dreamer, then I say, let's have a tag team match. And I say, let's have it right now.
You're on your way.
Now,
and keep in mind,
this is why I cannot do it. Because the closer I get, the wackier I'm being. And the bigger joke I'm making out of it. But she is achieving that level, and she is doing it with a sense of gravity.
Yes.
As if she is the President of the United States announcing that we are going to nuclear war.
Right.
I don't even know. It actually is a level of talent I cannot approach.
She's so spectacularly bad, And every time I see her, I think maybe this will be the week she improves, and she doesn't. And I'm actually quite happy about that, because maybe it's just me, but I look forward to Tiffany coming out and being bad. It's train wreck TV, sure. But she comes out, and I sit up, and I think, oh boy, Tiffany! And I get giddy with anticipation. I think, God, I hope she lives up to my expectations. I hope she's not any good this week. And then she delivers her delivery, and I laugh, and I hold my belly, and I fall down on the couch. It is great, 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 great stuff. I'm a fan of Tiffany. I am the fan of Tiffany.
Well, we've got an update on the jumping.
Okay.
Maybe I can laugh now, since it does not appear to be serious. It says, let's see here. Oh, Jesus. Hold on.
You just delete the message.
No. Cut his lip open. I guess he accidentally bumped someone who then went crazy. Same stupid shit as always. His friends had left already, so it was him and a bunch. That sucks.
Do I know this person?
No, I don't think so.
Do I know the girl? I bet I do.
No.
No? Okay, never mind.
I think you know.
If you're thinking about it, it's not who I thought it was.
Some of the individuals involved, but anyway. So that led to this tag team match, which was horrible. Dreamer, Christian, Henry, and Swagger. It went, I don't know, a while. Here, I don't want to rant too long, but I'm just going to say this very quickly. Luckily, I record this twice every week, the HD version and the SD version, the standard version. Standard version has been recording forever, and so I have it set to record an extra 15 minutes every week, dating back to
whenever the show started.
Yeah. So, anyway, ECW moved to 10 o'clock this week, from 9 to 10. Now, first off, they did a poor job on Raw making this known. So, with that said, they not only moved an hour later, but they added in a five-minute overrun without making it clear that this was going to happen. So, everybody that just recorded this show missed the last 5 minutes. I actually wish I would have. I wish I wouldn't recorded the second one. So, it was bad. Swagger ran Dreamer an exposed buckle, hit the doctor bomb for the pin, and that was the end of that.
It was a poor night for Jack Swagger. He was botching things left and right. He botched reverse DDT, and he botched a hot tag spot where they had the heat on Dreamer, and Dreamer and Swagger were both down selling, and they're fighting for the tag, and Dreamer reaches over, he tags in Christian, and Christian jumps in the ring of House of Fire, and he sees that Swagger is still crawling to the corner. And so Christian has to wait until Swagger crawls over to the corner and tags in Henry. That was bad. And there was more botchery around, and then he got the win. So the wrong man won this match. A below-average episode of ECW. There was one good match, and then nothing really special after that. Except Tiffany, who is definitely special. You can't argue with that.
She's special, all right. Let's play a quick song. Christian...
I feel like I've been watching Kozlov for like 3 years now.
Christian came... Well, you probably have.
I probably have.
Christian came out to host a peep show. Swagger said, this is so stupid. Christian told him to be a poor sport. Let's talk about Judgment Day. And Swagger said, no. Let's talk about Backlash and how you cheated. Showed footage of Christian exposing a buckle. Swagger ran into it. Christian said, well, it was nice that you should show me winning again. Everyone appreciates that. And he also said, I note you did not show the part where you undid the other buckle. You just got beat to the punch. So they had a little, he had a video package of his own making fun of Swagger's lisp. And ended up with Swagger saying, basically telling him, you know, Tiffany said that we cannot touch each other during this segment here, during your show. And Christian said, what's great about having your own show is you can determine when it's over. So it's over. And he punched him. Swagger rolled outside.
Mm-hmm.
This was cheating.
Sure.
Swagger is right. Jack Swagger was correct. This was cheating. She said you can't touch him on the whole fucking show. Anyway.
I don't know. This
segment did nothing.
No, it was a colossal failure.
But I like Jack Swagger.
Sure.
He grows on me more every week. I love his mic work.
Well, he was right. This was so stupid.
Yeah.
It was ridiculous to have these two guys who are going to have a fight on Sunday and have them be chummy on a talk show. This is not Lance, I think it was Lance, but he in one of his commentaries, he was talking about how, you know, you can hate someone and work with them, but I don't know. The whole thing was stupid. And then it was not entertaining. It did not make me want to see them fight.
They had many good segments, so there was no excuse for this not to be one of them.
Yeah, but this it failed.
All right. We had Christian and Jack Swagger for the ECW title. I gave this 3.5 stars. It was fun. They did a whole bunch of cool stuff. And finished, saw Swagger go for the Dr. Bomb. Christian slipped out, pulled down his straps. And then as he had the straps down, he rolled them up and pulled on the trunks for the pin. So the whole idea was Christian is, in fact, a cheater.
Yes.
But he doesn't care. He won.
He's a cheater. He's out-cheating Swagger.
So I guess at Extreme Rules, they'll have a match where I guess cheating is allowed.
Well, I think the story is supposed to be that he's a cheater, but he will only fight fire with fire. Because you will recall in their first match, he undid the turnbuckle, but only after Swagger undid the other one. This one, he grabbed the tights, but only after Swagger grabbed his.
Yep.
I was hoping when he pulled the straps down, the spot was going to be that Swagger's singlet straps were keeping his arms pinned to his sides and he would not defend himself. But sadly, they did not get that wacky.
We had Christian coming out with his title, and Jack Swagger was there, and they got to talking. Christian called him a dork, this sort of thing.
Fittingly, Swagger's lisp was in full effect this evening.
Yeah, and they were arguing about what kind of wacky match they were going to have at the pay-per-view when Tiffany came out. She's horrible.
She was bad. This is her worst performance in weeks, which made me happy.
Every time I hear her music, I cringe. So then she starts to explain that what Swagger did last week on Superstars did not go unnoticed. Well, to me, it did go unnoticed because I do not get WGN.
Right.
Now, normally in WWE, they very clearly and carefully explain what happened, and they usually have a video of it. No video. Nor did they actually explain what happened.
Okay, Hayes did say that Swagger screwed up a title match.
This was much later on, though. She just says, because of what you did, we are making this match at Extreme Rules a three-way. I immediately thought this meant she was going to fuck both of them. Because I didn't know what happened on Superstars. There was no mention of Tommy Dreamer before she mentioned this three-way. So she calls out Dreamer as the third man. And
then things got weird.
Swagger said this didn't count because Dreamer's contract expired the day before. It wasn't fair. And she said he'd signed a one-day extension, which I presume has a clause meaning that if he wins the title, his contract is renewed or whatever. So out he came. And as she's explaining all of this, Dreamer is doing a wacky dance. He's doing the Ric Flair strut, the Rick Rude hip swivel. He's basically acting like a drunkard at the Vegas convention.
Yes.
I just was sitting there looking at him going, what in the fuck is this guy doing here?
I wrote in giant letters, what in the fuck is Dreamer doing?
So finally, he beats them both up and he throws them out of the ring. Now I want to jump forward here. Later, there's an interview, and they ask him, why did you do this? Why did you do this stuff in the ring? Why did you throw me out, Christian asks. I'm your friend. And Dreamer's explaining, I'm really mad because you guys ignored me.
They did not like his strut.
Okay. Am I wrong, or was Tiffany still talking strutting in the background?
Tiffany was still talking, yes.
What is Dreamer's problem?
I have no idea.
Drug addict?
It could have been a trip.
He was acting completely irrationally. He was acting like a drug addict on this show.
He came out. He did, as you know, the Fargo struck. He stopped to wave in between Swagger and Christian, which unfortunately the camera's at the wrong angle, because that at least would have been really funny. Then he lifted up his shirt to expose what I guess is a slimmer belly than it used to be. He did the recruit swivel. He kept on dancing, and I kept thinking, a few months ago, I watched this man weep because he needed to get a title shot so badly. Now he's getting a title shot on pay-per-view, and he's doing a wacky dance.
Well, he's so happy.
The whole thing is a joke to him.
No need to cry anymore. I don't know.
This sucked.
They said Finley had an eye injury, and he was being removed from the main event, and Tiffany said that since Dreamer and Christian were responsible, too bad for them. It's now a handicap match.
That makes sense.
It does, I guess. So we have the Hart Dynasty, Harry Boy and Tyson Kidd, along with Jack Swagger, facing Dreamer and Christian. And
Natalya cut a long promo
saying, yep, Tyson was the last protege of Bret Hart. Harry was the only son of the Bulldog. She was the only daughter of Jim Neidhart. As noted, they had a good match, but the crowd was so dead that it was mind-numbing watching this thing for 15 minutes. So first, I think Christian... Let's see. Well, Dreamer got a hot tag first, if I recall correctly.
I think so, yeah.
So he got it, then he got beaten up. Then Christian got a hot tag. And by the way, hot tag, Wrong choice of words. Nobody cared. In fact, at one point, dudes were yelling, boring! And it was not all that boring. So, after the least hot tag of his entire career, Christian was running wild, and Swagger ended up hitting him with the doctor bomb for the pin. Finish was actually funny because he went for the doctor bomb, but then stopped, threw him into the post, then hit the doctor bomb.
There were many times in this point where spots could be heard being called because there's nobody there, and that was one of them. The match was kind of clunky at times. I Dreamer and Cage, I've never seen two guys who were supposed to be a tag team that didn't get along who pulled it off so well because they were never on the same page for double teams. Like, Christian would tag Dreamer in and then just stand there until Dreamer shouted, drop toe hold! And Christian would hit one and Dreamer hit the elbow, and so that was good. But other times, it felt like the guys were not on the same page at all. And maybe it's because they had to whisper spots since they could be heard, but it seems like one guy would be waiting for his opponent to call a spot or something. But it was mostly good. There was a bit... David Hartsmith was in, and last week I noted a boy, or 2 weeks ago, I guess, I noted a boy, I hope he doesn't screw this up for Tyson. And he was doing a lot of chin locks, and things were slowing down, and I thought, you know, you have two partners, and they're both better than you. Feel free to go tag them in at any time. So that was lame. Then he did finally hit, he picked up, I think it was Christian, no, it was Dreamer, because that was even more impressive. He picked up big fat Tommy Dreamer and hit the delayed vertical suplex, his father's trademark move.
Mm-hmm.
Both the announcers let it go, including the wrestling nerd Matt Stryker.
Yeah.
Oblivious. Hopefully they'll pick up on that next week.
Actually, I think they did mention it.
Perhaps I missed this one, but I'm
pretty sure they did.
I marked out, and I did not think they gave nearly enough reaction.
Well, that may be true. All right. So anyway, then he cut a promo talking about how this could be his very last match here on ECW. If he does not win the title on Sunday, he's done. And then Jack Swagger interrupted him and said, you will be done.
Swagger's music started, and Dreamer was outraged and looked at the ramp. And Swagger came out, and just for a few seconds, he just stood there with this very smug, very proud of himself look in his face, and it ruled.
This was actually, I don't know if it's actually going to sell a single pay-per-view, but they did everything they possibly could to make you interested in the match.
Sure.
So I got to give it a thumbs up.
So yes, and Dreamer finally said he would win, and that was it. And the main event, Tyson Kidd versus Christian Cage. It was, I had very high hopes for this match, and I don't think it quite met them. It was...
Are you kidding me?
It was a very good... by the end, it was awesome, and the people were going absolutely crazy. For a long time, and maybe it's because the Dreamer and Birchall match was so boring, but for a long time, the crowd was not really that into it, but by the end, people were going crazy. It was nuts. I had, like I said, very high hopes for this, so...
You need to go watch this match again. I cannot remember the last TV match I saw... where the moment it ended, I wanted to rewind to the beginning and watch the entire match from the opening bell all over again in its entirety. I watched every single second of this match. I didn't even take notes during this match.
Mm-hmm.
I stared at the screen for the entire time this match took place. This match was awesome. Anybody out there listening right now who did not see this match, or if you're in Canada and ECW airs today, tape this fucking show and watch this match. It was so great. Tyson Kidd is awesome. Christian is awesome. They were awesome together. They had the kind of match where... This was like a match where the fans should not be believing that Tyson Kidd is going to fucking beat Christian. Christian is the ECW champion. He's facing three guys or two guys at the pay-per-view in a three-way. Tyson's not even in the match. Tyson's out there with this match, and everybody was buying all of the near falls at the end.
At the end.
It was one great near fall after the other. You had Natalya and Harry on the outside pounding on the mats. This was actually, it was very much like the MVP Kofi match where the term wrestling is outlawed and shit like that, but this was like two guys having a competitive professional wrestling battle to see who was the better man. We never see that shit in WWE anymore. Now we've seen it two nights in a row.
That's true.
This was fucking great.
You know what this was like? It was, because as you noted and I agreed, they were into the near falls at the end. For the first three quarters of this match, the people had no faith in Tyson Kidd whatsoever. It was kind of like the first...
I disagree with that, by the way, but go on.
Well, I'm not sure I should make this analogy then, but it was like that one... ROH pay-per-view where Tyler Black won the title shot in the opener, and there was a lukewarm reaction because people thought he wouldn't win. And then by the end of his match with Nigel McGuinness, everyone was going apeshit. That's what happened here. They were I didn't think they were into this match at the beginning. By the end, they were all going crazy and jumping up and down, and that is what wrestlers are supposed to do. Moreover, when Christian finally won, people still were jumping up and down like he had accomplished something important by beating Tyson Kidd.
This was a great match, everybody.
I am talking myself more into loving it, actually.
Well, you go watch it again. If you have it on tape, go watch this.
Lord knows I'm wrong all the time.
Go watch this match again. This match blew my mind with its greatness. And hopefully it blew other people's minds as well, so we fucking get more shit like this with these guys. So anyway, that was that show, and it was fabulous. And I cannot believe we talked for an hour.
And then the last thing on the show was Dreamer congratulating Cage.
There was
a bit of an old school ECW bit where they had a run in and then another run in and then another run in. You had Harry Boy interfere at ringside, and then Swagger came out. And when Jack Swagger came out, as an aside, there was a fan who was old enough to not behave this way. He was appalled to see Jack Swagger come out, and he leapt to his feet and pointed and screamed, "No, don't interfere in this match." But eventually, Swagger came out, and then Dreamer came out to counter, and he took out Swagger and Harry Boy with a dive, and then after that, Christian got the win. And then Dreamer and Cage were left alone in the ring, and they sort of congratulated each other, and Christian gave him a little nod, like, thanks for not letting them kill me, and then Dreamer hit him with a DDT.
Guys, if you have not seen this, or if you have it on tape, or if you have the chance to record it, not only watch the match, but watch the DDT that Dreamer gives Christian. It's like the fucking greatest DDT, and Christian takes the greatest bump I ever saw. It's so awesome! So anyway, I was madly in love with this show, much like I was with TNA tonight, the live show in Kent. So anyway, on that love-filled note, let's play one last song and wrap it up. All right. ECW open up with Tiffany coming out. And this, by the way, has set a new record. We're 31 minutes into the show. We're just now starting to talk about wrestling.
Yay.
All right. Tiffany.
Hopefully we'll be done by 35 minutes.
Came out, ridiculous overacting as usual, said that Dreamer had won the title and signed a brand new contract, or was going to. He came out to do so. Christian interrupted. They had a little chit-chat back and forth. Dreamer was about to sign when Swagger's music hit. And the best part of all this was every time someone's music hit, it somehow prevented Dreamer from signing.
Of course. Yeah. You can't sign a contract where someone's music is playing. That would be rude.
So Swagger came out, and we had another argument. And it ended up with the good guys punching Swagger, and then Dreamer signed his contract. And as he was signing, Christian went up behind him. Or after he was done signing, and he was on the middle rope celebrating, Christian came up behind and powerbombed him through a table. And they said that Christian was getting his revenge from a few weeks ago when he got attacked by Tommy Dreamer. So anyway, it was a segment. It was fine. Tiffany is still horribly wooden.
She's actually much worse this week, which makes her better.
I guess so.
When she is adequate, she's just boring. When she's terrible, she is spectacular, and I just stare open mouth. And she was terrible this week, and it was awesome. And let's see, Christian came out in a sleeveless T-shirt. In an apparent attempt to look 98 pounds,
yeah,
is a bad, bad look for him. He's terribly slim, too slim for this business. And other than that, it was fine. It got done what it needed to get done. I did laugh at Swagger coming out wanting to. He threatened a lawsuit, and then he said Christian should join him in this lawsuit. Then said Dreamer should just quit, and then eventually they sent him packing. So, yeah, it was all fine.
We had an accident occurring backstage, and a stagehand explained that a mystery man in green had been involved.
We never did hear about this, did we?
Apparently they're bringing the midget back, I guess.
Or Hurricane.
I don't know. Or they forgot. Yeah, actually, a bunch of shit fell down, so maybe it was the Hurricane. You know? Wind blew over. Wind blew by.
That would be a fantastic gimmick if everywhere he walked, things were blown away.
Sure. Yeah. And a mystery man in green spun through.
Yes.
What if he came out and just spun his way down to the ring?
And all the fans took bumps.
Sure.
Yeah.
I got ideas here. So anyway, he... Christian explained that what he'd done to Dreamer was a receipt from a few weeks back. Tiffany was questioning him, and she said, "Well, you fucked yourself because he was supposed to be your partner tonight, and now he's too hurt to compete." Yes, the king of hardcore, Tommy Dreamer, took one powerbomb through a table, and he cannot compete in the ECW main event.
Remember that time he went off the crow's nest through like three tables?
Oh, yeah. So anyway, she said the only available option was for him to team with Jack Swagger in the main event.
Sure.
This was TNA-rific.
He even suggested an alternative. Let's just make it a singles match, he said.
Yeah.
No. The only alternative is to book you with Jack Swagger. There's nothing else that can be done.
Christian and Swagger were in the dressing room getting ready, and Swagger told him, you know, I don't want to team with you either, but I'm a winner, and all you need to do is worry about holding up your end of the bargain, which, of course, was foreshadowing.
And Cage said, you're a toolbox.
New Heart Foundation against Christian and Swagger. They had a pretty damn fun little match. I could watch Christian and Tyson Kidd wrestle every day.
I did describe this as a slice of heaven in my notes.
For like the rest of time.
Yeah.
And anyway, Christian got the heat on him. And Swagger actually had been pissed at Christian for not doing what he asked. So he shoved him and shoved him right into a kick. And they beat on him for a while. And then Christian finally went to make the hot tag, put out his hand. Swagger went to slap it, but Christian just pulled it out of the way and slapped him. And then he made his own comeback and was running wild on both guys. And he finally went for the kill switch on Tyson. But in mid-move, Swagger snapped his neck on the top rope. And then they hit the heart attack and it was over. Very, very good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And heels went to work on Christian afterwards. But Tommy Dreamer ran down to make the save. The same Tommy Dreamer who was so injured that 10 minutes earlier he was too hurt to work this match.
He got better.
This happens like all the time on this show now.
Something's amiss.
So anyway.
Something does not add up here, yes. I was expecting, since the storyline was the main eventers were attempting to not get along, that they would fight during this match, but then they would still triumph over the young up-and-coming tag team, because it's WWE, and that's usually what they do. But no, the main eventers didn't get along, and then the young up-and-coming tag team got a win. That made me happy. And Tyson Kidd remains my favorite wrestler, so just for this segment alone, I give this show a thumbs up.
He is awesome. He is quite awesome. So, that's ECW, everybody. Then we had Jack Swagger and Tommy Dreamer, and I guarantee this is a 5-star lock. Dreamer will not be the ECW champion by the time June is over. It was one thing on Raw. When you watch Raw and you assume, okay, nobody that watches this show actually watches ECW. But on ECW, nobody gave a shit about this match. And this was not even like a match where nobody gave a shit early. Then they started doing stuff at the end and the crowd got into it. No. Nobody gave a shit about this match the entire fucking time. And ended up with Swagger getting the pin, setting up a title match at some point. And, afterwards, Finley hit the ring. Swagger bailed, so Finley hit Dreamer. Then Christian ran in. Swagger tossed him outside, and Finley laid out Swagger. So Finley basically just laid out everybody. And fans hated Finley all night until he finally hit Swagger, and then they cheered. And that's when the show ended. So there you go. Went off a cliff at the end. A cliff!
I have to disagree somewhat. There were go, Tommy, go chants. This was not... He was not Jeff Hardy in Carolina or anything, but...
No shit.
But it was a typical WWE crowd reaction.
No, I strongly disagree that this was typical.
And as far as the match itself goes, I know I'm the only person who thought this, but I was one of the very few people taking notes, but I love this match because Jack Swagger's the awesome all-American wrestler. He did all his amateur stuff, but he only did it to cut Dreamer off. So every time he did an amateur move, it mattered. Usually he would just stomp him or do a bear hug, which I guess is an amateur move, but Dreamer would get a hope spot, like he did a sunset flip, and Swagger would, like, he'd do a single leg takedown to cut him off, or he would do an amateur duck under into an abdominal stretch, or what the hell else does he do? He did a belly-to-belly suplex at one point. It was all really cool. And they had their, you know, it was a Tommy Dreamer match. You get to see him, like, run the ropes, which is always good comedy. And then he went for that senton off the apron he's been doing, which he ended up being caught and turned into a power slam onto the pretty black mat. That looked like it sucked. But the teacher identified this move, the big senton off the apron, as the FMF, which I assume is the fat motherfucker.
I could have sworn he called it a cannonball.
Somewhere FMF came in, but I assume it's fat motherfucker, which is why they never said. I also like fat man flying. I think that'd be a good name for a move.
Could be.
So that was ECW.
Could be. You're the only one that cared.
I guarantee you. And he actually won. Going back to all the amateur stuff, this finishing move was the Oklahoma roll. So
well, that was cool. And the spot into the abdominal stretch actually was cool. But everybody, if you didn't see this match, just believe me. Nobody gave a fuck about this match, and I guarantee Tommy Dreamer's losing the title by the end of June.
You're probably right. Probably right there. I also want to note, Finley interfered, or I shouldn't say interfered. He did two run-ins in the show. Not one of them came before the finish.
Yeah.
They let guys have clean finishes. Then he ran out and hit them with his whacking stick. And you know what? It still worked.
His whacking stick. Let's play a song. Christian and Dreamer against Swagger and Henry. Oh, this match. I abhorred this match. Like, with a passion. We had Swagger and Christian working the match early. Which, at least, that was all right. So, they're working the match. And, they get the heat on Dreamer. Go to commercial, they come back, the heat is now on Christian. So then Dreamer gets the coldest hot tag I've ever seen.
Indeed.
Then they cut him off. Then Christian gets a hot tag, which I think is about the fourth or fifth one in this match alone. Runs wild. Atlas gets involved. Pulls the dude out of the ring or whatever. Henry finally gives Christian a body block into the post. Swagger hits the doctor bomb for the pin. Again, this match did nobody any favors. The only thing about this match that was any good at all was when the teacher explained that Mark Henry had a documented squat thrust in excess of 1,000 pounds.
Sure.
A 1,000-pound squat thrust. I do not ever want to see that.
Are you calling the teacher a liar?
No, I do not ever want to see Mark Henry do a 1,000-pound squat thrust.
All right. I won't go no further.
Would a rhinoceros be involved?
Perhaps.
What would he have to be violating?
I don't know. I don't have an answer.
What sort of machine registers the power of a squat thrust? I picture like a bull with like a... pole attached to it.
I was just going to say.
And the harder you thrust, the higher the red line goes on the pole.
Huh. I don't even know. Wow.
Disgusting.
I do not have an answer to this question.
Completely disgusting.
Maybe you attach a cable to your hips, and as you thrust, it pulls the cable.
That's another good one. Like one of the fat jigglers they used to put around you.
Yes, exactly.
You put one of those around your stomach. And then
you squat thrust.
You squat thrust repeatedly.
And it says 1,000 pounds.
Yeah.
Indeed. I took exactly zero notes in this match, so you can tell it made quite the impact. I do recall two or three times I got to watch Tommy Dreamer run. And it never gets old. It makes me laugh every time. There's a point after Atlas interfered, and he was at ringside, and Dreamer jumped down. And sadly, he was on the side away from the camera, so you could only really watch his head bob back and forth, but... to get halfway across the ring, I believe he took 8 steps.
Very possible.
And he's amazing. As a world champion, I don't buy it, but he makes me laugh.
No, of all the fucking guys in the ring, it was inconceivable that he, is the champion.
Yes, he's the best wrestler, theoretically.
This is really putting a damper on my ability to rant this tongue injury. Thankfully, the show was good. I wish I could find the squat thrust drop. I am going to let you start talking about the scramble match since you guys decided to start it before they explained the rules. I don't need to get into that here, but go for it.
I don't know. Everything we've had to say about scramble matches has been said before, except that I didn't even realize the times were was messed with. Apparently this went 14 minutes and change instead of the advertised 20. And I'm not going to complain because the less time devoted to this match, the better. It was not horrible. But the match itself is so stupid. The intervals, it doesn't make sense why you'd have intervals. You think everyone would just want to be in the beginning. There's no benefit to being in last like there is in the Royal Rumble because then you have less time to try and pin somebody. But, you know, it was what it was. They did some stuff. I remember almost nothing about it except Tommy Dreamer won and then was like surprised as if he himself was not fully aware of the rules. His own victory caught him off guard.
Yeah.
Or maybe it's that he had not won on pay-per-view in so damn long, except in last month, of course, that he was not prepared for that to celebrate. But otherwise, you know, who cares? And it's a useless match for a useless belt.
I'm looking at the deal here, the trending for the pay-per-view. We've done some of this in the past to see how they compare to other pay-per-views. And the Extreme Rules show, which took place earlier this month, I believe, more than double the interest of WWE Bash. That's bad.
Is that?
That's like really bad.
Are you just in that based on poll results on our site, or?
No, we have some trending stuff that we use.
I see.
What was the last UFC pay-per-view? The UFC 99? I believe that was the.
I don't even pay attention to the numbers anymore.
Yeah, UFC 99 is like, let's see here, double, triple. It's over triple what the Extreme Rules show did, and Extreme Rules is over double what the Bash did. So, not looking good.
No buys.
Everybody.
Literally, there weren't any buys.
So, yeah, the Scramble match, they said 3 minutes, but it was like a little more than 3 minutes for most of the things here, and they did a bunch of stuff. Guys were getting pins, apparently in the building. Apparently in the building, nobody had any idea what the fuck was going on or what the rules were. And then Tommy Dreamer won when they put the final clock on the screen, and there you go.
Yes, Tommy Dreamer, who at one point he was it. He was still going for pins. That was dumb. Guys would make a cover, and someone else would break it up, even though it made no difference to them.
So yeah, random dumb. Guys were breaking up covers.
If you're not it, and then say you're Mark Henry, and you're not it, and then Tommy Dreamer goes to pin Christian, why should you care?
Yeah, there were guys randomly breaking up pins, and Tommy Dreamer still attempting to get pinned with seconds left. So even the guys didn't seem to know what the hell was going on.
So,
and then when it was over, the screen announced a new ECW champion.
Even though he came into the match with the belt and, he left with it, apparently he is the new champion. So a lot to hate here. People are criticizing me and say, hey, it's your job. You should put some kind of effort into paying attention. And I say, no, I refuse.
Let me look at the, I wonder if WWE.com has a title history section.
It does.
Does it? Let's see if they've listing if they're listing Tommy Dreamer as a two-time.
Well, he's a three. It would be three-time now.
Let's see. Where would this be? History?
It's on. It's over on the left somewhere. Very helpful.
Yeah. Thanks. Superstars, divas, history.
Try history.
History. This should not be horribly difficult. WWE referees? Okay, I gotta click that. Hold on a second.
A tangent.
Since they're not allowed to be named. God, look at that. Holy shit! Goose Mahoney is a WWE referee now.
I thought... Is he the guy who...
Of Ohio Valley fame.
Is he the one who we thought he was great and he... Didn't he get called up once we were totally excited? And we just forgot about him?
Jesus, I never knew that. Let me see if they've got a bio here.
He's the one who never stops moving, right?
He was the Ohio Valley referee.
Yeah, but there was a kid in Ohio Valley, or maybe it was Derby City, but he was a ref who literally never stopped moving. And we loved him in the minor leagues, and then I remember he got called up, and we got totally excited, and then the thrill wore off, and we forgot about him.
Wow.
I think that's what happened.
Well, there you go. Goose Mahoney debuted in 2008.
Oh.
There you go. So we've got Goose Mahoney, Chad Patton, Charles Robinson, Jack Doan, John Cone... Yes, a Jack Doan and a John Cone. No wonder they're not allowing them to say the referees' names. Marty Elias, Mike Chioda, and Scott Armstrong. Wow. All right, where the fuck is the title history? Inside WWE. Let's try that. If this doesn't work pretty soon, I'm going to give it up. Maybe Circle of Champions. What the hell's that?
That's like their fan... Make-A-Wish dealy or something.
Okay, I'm gonna search just title history. I wonder if they're allowed to be called titles. Maybe there's another word like...
Championship.
Championship history.
Don't say belt.
Yeah, you cannot say belt history. Oh, there you go. Inside WWE. World Heavyweight, blah, blah, blah. Intercontinental. Okay, this is awesome.
the
order? Entire first page. We've got World Heavyweight title, WWE title, Tag Team, Women's... Intercontinental, United States, Tag Team, Cruiserweight, still no ECW. We're now on page 2. Divas, oh, there it is. It's underneath the Divas Championship. All right, here's
I know somewhere they have a page that is just all the champions.
Well, there you go. It's Tommy Dreamer is listed only as a one-time champion, so the graphic undoubtedly screwed up.
But they were as confused as we were.
They go all the way back to Shane Douglas in 1994.
Yeah.
So he defeated N.A.
Not available.
Rob Van Dam also beat an NA, and Matt Hardy beat an NA. Wow, there you go. What a tangent that was right there. All right. Anyway, back to... actually, you know what? Let me do one more thing. I'm going to search WWE.com for belt. Wow, look at that.
Nothing came up?
There's a lot of them. Well, actually, it's all replica. You can call it a belt...
If it's fake.
If you're a replica belt.
I see.
Yeah. Oh, look at this. Oh, you have to go all the way back to 2005 to see... Cena talks about his new belt. Wow.
Try searching for wrestler.
Okay. Or wrestling would also be good.
Or wrestling.
Oh, shit. That searches Google. Fucking. WWE.com. You know the line, everybody.
What it can do?
It can suck my dick. All right. Wrestler. Did you mean wrestler? Apparently typed it in wrong. I wish you would have said, did you mean sports entertainer?
That would be awesome. Or superstar.
A preview of the wrestler.
Oh, of course.
Boxer versus wrestler confrontations from WrestleMania 24. Wow. More stuff about the wrestler. It's all about the wrestler.
Yeah.
Wow, look at that. I guess they just couldn't bring themselves to say boxer versus sports entertainer.
Pity.
Angle named greatest shoot wrestler of all time. Jesus, you got to go back to Luna Vachon. As the daughter of a wrestler. Let me do one more.
Okay.
Wrestling. Oh, shit, I did it again. WWE.com. We are wasting a lot of time.
No, this is time well spent. Talking about wrestling is dumb. Making fun of their stupid website.
There are a million references, but it's all to the name World Wrestling Federation.
Mm.
There's like absolutely no mentions here, at least on the first couple of
nothing
pages.
Like wrestling is fun or we like wrestling?
Nope, nothing. It's all just World Wrestling Entertainment references. Well, there you go, everybody. Huh, how about that? Anything else that they...
I'm trying to think. I'm thinking of personalities who might be banned. I say Savage, but they just released his DVD.
Frank Shamrock?
Sure.
They did... Savage is they did release a DVD, but they also were confiscating Savage signs at the TV.
Yes.
That's awesome.